Right, jet setters. Haven't done one for like a week or so. Been doing a bit of music and really just letting some stuff run. Bit of a step back though. This is what I'm seeing when I look at equities, right? This is the Dow. These megaphone patterns, reverse symmetrical triangles, whatever you call them. To me, they're a very bearish thing, right? This says uncertainty, because you've got higher highs, lower lows, higher highs, lower lows, higher highs, lower lows, right there. You can see it. Well, I'm doing it on the lines. You can see a bit more clearly on the lines, but that is the range that it has been going in, and it's been getting wider over time. That's not a good sign, right? Equity markets thrive on certainty. And the other thing these things have a habit of is stalling around the middle before tanking. That's my takeaway when I look at the Dow at the moment. When I look at the Russell, it's doing one of my favorite kind of patterns, where it has, and everyone rushes into the party. They all get there and they kind of like, you know, mingle, right? New people come, old people leave. And then when it's time to get out, they kind of run for the doors pretty quickly. It's having a bit of a fight here. But to me, it's got a long way to go down. And if you take a look at a whole lot of other stocks that and markets, this is quite an established pattern in a lot of things. Everything from, I've done videos on it before, like the 2-year bonds in the US, got a classic one. Bonds globally have actually got them. Look at Peloton, look at, if you're in Australia, look at Afterpay, look at Facebook, look at Spotify, a lot of these big tech companies, they've all got them, and it's pretty dire. This is not a good sign. This is not a reversal, right? This is a continuation kind of pattern. We're gonna look at the Nasdaq. You know, this is going back, you know, GFC, right? You know, overblown. I've talked about these channels before, where these channels, that's his normal, 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 right? Normal growth over time. Abnormal, right? So that's been abnormal, right? And of course, it's starting to come back. And then when we start to zoom in, we can see how it's doing the wedding cake routine, right? I'm not sure if it shows up more clearly there. I guess it does. Yeah. But you see, maybe it's a little bit lower, right? But you can see how it's stormed up, had a few levels, and it's kind of tested them and rejected them on the way down as well. There's even a little one in there, right? Where it just keeps, as much as it ratcheted up here, right, it ratchets down. This is not a bullish formation. This is called rolling over, right? This is not a good sign. See, there's another one here. Basically all these ones here, they've come back and they've kind of tested. This is quite a retracement, right? But not particularly significant in the scheme of things. You can see it's bang on the 61, right? And it failed. It failed to beat that high, right? And it failed at this level here, which it had tested before. The extension takes it down to like 11,000. There's a bit of a gap in here, which you see a bit more on the weekly and on the daily in there. But this level, noticeably, it takes it into this little zone here, which is, that was the US elections kind of in there, when it kind of popped out in November 20. And on vaccine news, of course, that's the last time it really had a bit of a fierce fight, I guess, here as well. But that's a bit more of a likely target in my opinion. So that's the Nasdaq. When we, so that's So the Dow says topping pattern, increasingly uncertainty. This says it's started, it's broken a big level and it's having a pause. This one is wedding caking on the way down. When we look at the S&P, this is something we looked at before. This is a monthly, like 100, you know, from the 74 to 87, from 87 up to the GFC, from post GFC low, sorry, to .com, from GFC low to basically January, it's all 155 months. Literally, check it out. So it says it's time, it's been cooked. I remember talking about this since the beginning of the year. As per the Nasdaq, it is on some, where can we draw this? It is on some pretty hefty resistance on that trend. Okay, you can see it there. Let me get rid of the Bollinger to make it a bit clearer. All right, let's go this. Right, so it's busted through that, the overcooked thing. It's come back and it's kind of testing it on the way down. There is also this line here. And this was a megaphone that it actually shot right through, right? And I was convinced this one was gonna blow, but you can see it, this megaphone thing, when it came back to the middle here, it didn't fail at the middle, right? Right? Unlike what's been happening at the Dow, right? So the Dow's kind of done this, right? But it's failed here in the S&P back in post the COVID, it shot through. And this is starting to turn and wedding cake on the way down a little bit as well. And the extension takes it to, into this zone here down of like 4,000, which I've had in my mind for a while. So it really is turning. I'm short the equity markets. And when I look at the Aussie market, it's a bit different to the US ones because it's not as tech heavy and it's basically a bit old school, it's banks and miners. But it's turned, this morning or overnight, same as the US market, came off some big tops there. And one of the indicators, there's only really kind of two technical indicators that I find work for me. One of them is the RSIs and the other is the Bollinger Bands. The RSIs here, the signal I look for is when it's overbought on the 1, 2 and 4 hourly and starts showing some bit of negative divergence. This wasn't really negative divergence, but it was flat there and the momentum was coming off. So to me, and you can see it a bit more clearly on the hourly, it said it wasn't going up with that weakening momentum, but it was certainly from the top and starting to come down, and it's come down to just coming down to this level in here. Whether it goes further or not, I don't know, but I'm still staying short. There's just too much weird stuff going around on the planet at the moment. They're the equity markets. With the bonds, I'm short the tens, the twos. I had to put a steepener on when it was when this curve flattened to slightly inverted. I've still got that on. I'm going to build it up as it. I expect it's going to flatten again. The 10 years, this is the blue line here. The projection for the 10 years is up to like basically 320, right? Which is this level in here, that 2018 high. It's got more to run. The twos, that's that big rollover pattern that we're seeing the other way around on the Russell. Now the thing that's interesting this time around is when, like, people talk about the spread, right? A lot. When you look at the spread, you've also got to look at the overall trend in rates as well, because you can see where it flattens, it's when it comes up against this trend line, right? That's when it flattens. I mean, here it kind of stayed pretty flat all the way down. But when it comes up here, it inevitably flattens and then pulls back, okay? So you see how back here, this is going back to like the late 1980s, right? It comes up, it flattens, and then it pulls back. It flattens, and then it pulls back. The rates all pull back. It flattens, and it pulls back. The pullback is led by the 2 years. Right? Flattens, pull back. 2 years over sell more, right? So the steepening is done by the 2 year yields falling, right? So the 2 year yields squeeze it, okay, and they come up. It flattens, then the 2 year yields pull back and everything eases up. So the 2 year yields are, you can see, a lot more volatile than the tens, right? Same thing here, 2 years ran up, squeeze against the tens, flattened, comes back here. Now this is different in a way because really like the tens have been much more aggressive than the twos, really. The twos are catching up. So the 2 years haven't quite squeezed the tens yet has busted through this line. So I think it's got more to go, and I think it will come back and flatten again before the 2 years then lead the steepening. That's that one. All right, gold. Let's have a look at gold. This is like a monthly with gold. This is kind of why bearish gold does this. This is one of the patterns that I kind of look for. Big run up, consolidation, sell off fills that gap, right? Here, had a big run up, little consolidation there, series of lower highs, came back. Let's go to a weekly. Run up, consolidation, couple of lower highs, came back down. Run up, consolidation, some lower highs, came back down. Ran up, consolidation, lower highs, hasn't quite sustained that. To my mind, that is coming down. I don't have anything on gold at the moment, actually. I only had short little positions and got burned all the time. I'll tell you about that later. The other thing is, when does it bust out, right? It busts out when it does the opposite, right? Where you've got a horizontal neckline and higher lows, right? So here you've got this horizontal line here and these increasing lows. We don't really have that yet, right? So the people that talk about having the gold like it's on for a run, right? We've got lower highs with a hiccup, right? Which is what we had here, lower highs with a hiccup. Right, against a reasonably flat neckline in here. Okay. This is the opposite, and so it broke up. Right? Same back here. Had a bit of a neckline here, increasing higher lows. Those lows are out, and it popped. This is the other way around, right? Pops against the horizontal. You go, pops against the horizontal, you go, pops against the horizontal. False break in my mind. So that's where we're at with gold. And you can see here, right, although it had this big build up here, this run up, same as what we saw here, the pattern at the top was vastly different, right? Because it was the upside down version of that, right? That's what's going on. And there was another one like back here, right? That one. So same thing, big run up, the highs coming down against some stable support. So that's gold. So I'm still looking for it to break lower. And in here, this one to me is doing the same thing. We're a run up, we've got some lower highs there. That 1920 level is going to be critical, and I think it could well, if it breaks that, that's going to be my signal to sell and get joined on the way down. The other one that I've got on is some German bonds, which I'm short as well. Similar story to the US, you know, 10 years, but these yields are much lower. It's AAA, Australia's AAA, and there's like, you know, 200 points difference right between the yields. So to me, and their inflation is much higher than Australia. So that's one of the reasons I think they've got like a fair way to run. It hasn't broken this trend line here. The curve hasn't gone, it's had a little stab of going flat there, hasn't flattened yet. These 2 years, I sold some of those the other day. They'll push it up. Look, so that's really what I'm looking at. But the other thing I'm gonna talk about as well is one of my frustrations is when people do these, you know, to me, it's a market commentary, right? Education, that's bullshit, man. This is like a market commentary. And to me, it's a trading diary, right? A lot of the people, they don't talk about really what they've got on, right? You can see some of my things here, right? Tabs, right? This is basically what I've been running, keeping track of since COVID. This is what's been going on for me since I started doing these videos, right? So that's why I'm not going back to, well, I've been doing trading like for 20 something years, right? I'm not gonna go back all the way. But this is since I've started been doing these videos, right? This is how much money I've made. You can work out a multiplier for yourself. I'm not gonna tell you the real figures. And these are the number of trades, right? And you can see how pretty clearly it fits the old adage. Well, for me, it's not an 80-20 rule. For me, it's an 85-15 rule, where 85% of what I've made, right? So out of the 300 and something biscuits I've made, it's 340 biscuits, add them up, it's come from 15% of the trades, right? And the other, like 85% of trades, right, in here, has given me 15% of what I've made. This was like an oil trade, this was in the equity markets, sold a put, got it exercised, collected some dividends. That's the way I played the oil market, because the particular equity, Woodside Petroleum, it had lagged the boom in the oil market, and so I got on by selling a an at the money put, short dated. And that's really what played out there. This is what I made out of the bonds, the German bonds, the US bonds, the Australian bonds, and these are some equity options. So when I do equity options, typically it's all selling vol, selling calls, selling puts, right? I've never made any money out of buying options, always selling. If you're thinking about selling options, naked options, you got rocks in your head, don't do it. Similarly, trading these markets, I've traded more during futures. If you're thinking about doing that, don't do it. You got rocks in your head, right? If you need someone like me to teach you how to trade options and futures, then you should not be trading them. That's it, full stop. In terms of any advice I give you, the stuff that I do, don't touch it. Do not do it, right? It is very risky. People blow up. Now I'm also gonna, so that's my profit over the last 6 months, and you can see here, I'm, you know, the percentage of the profit, 32% of my profit has come from 1% of the trades, right? So here, this is like 15%, right? So 15% of the trades have given me, this is 85% of my profit. Now, one of the things, you will hear people who talk about this, in that the most traders, their profits come from very few trades, where you get the compelling position and you just sit on it. And you can see, right, this is the market I'm most actively trading, right? And a lot of us, you know, punting around. Like, it's hard yards. You do a lot of work for not much gain, right? These bonds, I've done bugger all trades in them, but it's from a macro perspective. So this, right, is technical trading, right? This is on technicals. This is on technical analysis, right? What's this? Macroeconomics, right? Equity options, I'll ignore that a little bit. This is pure and utter, like that and these ones, pure and utter macroeconomic trades. Right? This, pure and utter macroeconomic trades. These actually are kind of macroeconomic trades underlying, right? This is technical analysis. This is technical analysis. This is technical analysis. This is technical analysis, right? So when I say technical analysis is bullshit, right? That is exactly why, right? Macroeconomic analysis, and you look at these bars, they're the right way around, where you pay off, right? Is much more than your effort, you know? You want things that are low effort, high payoff, 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 right? Look at the ones that are the other way around. High effort, low payoff, high effort, low payoff, high effort, low payoff, negative payoff, high effort, high payoff, right? Technical analysis and punting around is a high effort, low payoff, and that spells help, right? So that's why I'm saying if you're looking at trading the markets by technical analysis, it's a joke, right? And as I said before, there isn't a hedge fund in the world, right, whose strategy is technical analysis. The hedge funds in the world are macro hedge funds. You do get some quant ones, right, but quant is very different from just technical analysis, looking at trends and support and resistance and head and shoulder patterns and stupid shit like that, right? You get macro hedge funds, right? You get equity hedge funds, you know, you trade, you know, equities, of course, right? But you don't get ones that just say, oh, look, we're a technical analysis one on the, you know, equity markets, on commodities, on currencies. They don't exist, right? And they don't exist because, look at this, right? I've worked for, you know, an investment bank for over 20 years, like in trading, so I know what I'm talking about. High effort, low payoff, high effort, low payoff, high effort, low payoff, high effort, low payoff. That is technical analysis, right? You'll lose money doing it. Low effort, high payoff, low effort, high payoff, low effort, high payoff, low payoff. That's macroeconomics, right? It pays off. Now, the other thing I'm going to talk about is this one. Right, this is good. The trading bullshitter's routine, right? So this is the one dedicated to Greg Secker. This is another little rant and rave, right? If you come across anyone that's doing these channels and they boast about their lifestyle, I had a shit life, but look at me now, photos with celebrities, holidaying in fancy places, claiming I even had cancer once, run a million miles, right? If they talk about there's secrets, I can lure you in by promising not only that there are secrets, which there aren't, but I can unlock them for you. That is bullshit, man. That is a classic sucker punch to lure you in saying you can be successful like me. It's secrets, but I can do it. The secret to my success. How do you do it? Sign up for a free webinar or a heavily discounted training course. Why do they do that? So that, right, I can get in touch with you, you give me your details, and I can get my manipulative little tentacles around you and start selling you more shit, right? Then they also add in, oh, it's only 1 to 2 hours a day. Why do they say that? Because that's the way in which they sell their screening systems. They're unicorns, right? They are bullshit, right? Only 1 to 2 hours a day, you can have a lifestyle like me. This is the secret that I'm going to unlock. Get my free webinar, so I'll get your details. And to do that, you know what you have to do? You have to pay them, right, to buy a screening system, right? The thing they don't tell you, right, is that once they've sold you something, they're going to upsell you and suck you in even further. They're going to get your friends and family in. They're going to get their money, right? They're going to put you in their trading room and get you to trade at ridiculously wide spreads through their trading business, right? If anyone's pulling this stunt on you, Greg Secker, if you're out there, and there's others, run like a million miles. There's no shortage of them, right? The reason why I do this is because I know that YouTube puts up those ass wipes videos in your feed when you start Googling, you know, S&P 500 technical analysis, right? Now, this is the other one. These guys are just as bad. The technical analysis is bullshit as routine. You say, this is educational. That's a regulatory smokescreen, right? That's just them to say, look, you know, I'm not providing advice. It's just education. Yeah, whatever, right? Hit like and subscribe. They all say that. I never say that. I don't care if you hit like and subscribe at all. Couldn't give a rat's ass. This is really for my benefit, right? Why do they do that? So they can start monetizing you. The next one is join my chat room. Ah, why is that? It's because they're monetizing routine again, right? The next one is, the thing they don't tell you is they don't say, oh, I've got no relevant university degree or industry experience. Right? Look at them. Look at these guys. Right? There's no shortage of them. I won't name it. Actually, I will name it, shame. This guy called FX Evolution from Tom. He's got no relevant university degree or industry experience. There's another guy called, figuring out money, Michael Silver. some of his stuff's okay, right? But he doesn't. He's from marketing. He doesn't have a relevant university degree or industry experience. He doesn't do it. There's another guy, John Howe. He's a bullshitter, man. He's got no relevant university degree or industry experience. So if they don't have a relevant university degree or industry experience, how are they in a position to educate you? Huh? Greg Secker. He doesn't have any relevant university degree. I think his degree's in I don't know what it is, but it is certainly not anything remotely related to financial markets. He's offside in Australia in another Greg. He's got a degree and background in, it's like media and marketing, right? As far as industry experience, Greg Secker, he was a VP at a bucket shop bank, Mellon Bank, 20 years ago, where he worked there for 5 years as a trader's assistant. Claims he was a vice president. Vice president is like junior shit kicker, right, in that business. Trust me, I worked in it, I know. Up to like a half of the workforce at investment banks is vice president or above, right? Is nothing special whatsoever. And if you're not a VP within 5 years, then your title's sackable material. And if it was that good, why did he leave, right? To become an educator, despite not having a university degree, and I would actually say relevant industry experience, he wasn't actually trading. And of course, the other thing they do, they don't tell you the positions they've got. Why? Because in all likelihood, they don't have any. And why don't they have them? Because they tried it and they got burnt. Right? So if you come across any of these technical and other bullshitters, right? If they say it's education, ring a bell, right? If they start saying he'd like him to subscribe, ring another bell. If they want you to join a chat room, ring another bell, right? Look at their degree and industry experience, right? And if they've got it, right, then yeah, listen to them. If they don't, they're full of shit, right? Well, the odds are they're full of shit, right? And if they don't tell you the position they've got, right, then don't listen to them, right? Because inevitably they don't have them because they traded and they tried it and they got burned. And what happened to them? They were trading on technical analysis where this is what happens. Right? We have high effort, low payoff, high effort, low payoff, high effort, low payoff, high effort, low payoff. They weren't trading on good macroeconomic fundamentals, right? This is what goes on, right? Where you've got low effort, high payoff, low effort, high payoff, low effort, high payoff, low effort, high payoff. This is what you want to be doing. Not that, right? That's certainly my experience. 85% of what I've made over the last 6 months has come from 15% of the trades, and it has not been for, not to say this is still material money. I've still been making money, won't hand it back, so it's still been profitable, but where is the risk reward? Okay, it's on the left hand side, right? As I said, it's been profitable here, like that, 28 biscuits, 10 biscuits, 22 biscuits, bugger all here, these are my losses. Like, still bank that, so don't knock it, right? But that is the game you're playing, be aware of it. Anyway, look, that's it for today. I hope that's been helpful. We'll catch you later, ciao.